بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإذ يرفع إبراهيم القواعد من البيت وإسماعيل ربنا تقبل منا ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم. The ayah which I've just recited, it's a famous ayah, and you will find it inshallah in Surah Al-Baqarah, and it is verse 127. You'll find it in juz number 1. And we always say these things, so inshallah when we go back we can look up these things and expand a little bit more. And it translates as follows: and mention Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The statement is made to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so he can mention it to his nation, and if it is mentioned to his nation in the Quran, it is mentioned to the whole of humanity, because Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has taken it upon himself to preserve it till the very end of the time, inshallah. وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ. And mention Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to your nation, to the Muslims, when Ibrahim alayhi salam is raising, and we need to be careful about the wording here, raising the bases of the house. وإسماعيل, and Ismail was with him. So if you translate it in more modern language, when Ibrahim and Ismail, both of them, they are raising the bases of the house. And they were both saying, ربنا تقبل منا. O our Lord, please accept our actions. إنك أنت السميع العليم. You, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are the one who is Sami'. Sami' is the one who can hear everything. Alim is from it, it comes from ilm. Ilm is knowledge. Alim is a knowledgeable scholar. Alim is the one who know. Allah is Al-Alim. Al with the most knowledgeable. Innaka anta Sami' al-Alim. We are told in the tradition of the hadith that Ibrahim alayhi salam said to Ismail, his son, Inna Allah amarani bi amrin. And look at the, we contemplate about these stories so that we can learn from it how Ibrahim alayhi salam communicated with Ismail. So there is a lesson for us how we communicate with our children as well. And the purpose will become clear in a second. So he said to him, إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَانِي بِأَمْرٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded me with something. He's saying to his son. قال إسماعيل عليه السلام replied, فَاصْنَعْ مَا أَمَرَكَ رَبُّكَ. Allah. Instead of Ibrahim عليه السلام, he's being commanded to do something, and here confine the commander to himself only, he gathered his son in the action and allowed his son to participate and take a reward for everything that they both do. His son is saying, do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded you to do. So both of them are submitting to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَالَ وَتُعِينُنِي. Will you help me in that thing? وَتُعِينُنِي. Are you going to help me? قَالَ وَأُعِينُكَ. Yes, I will help you. And this, brothers, this tiny little one word is the essence of the problems that we have today as the Muslim Ummah. The Muslim Ummah before were active Ummah. Everyone participates. Today, one of the biggest problems that we have become a nation of spectators. As I said, I think it was last week, we are not required, just to take the analogy, Islam does not require us to watch football. Islam requires us to play football, to participate. Will you help me? What happened to Bani Israel? قَالَ اذْهَبْ أَنْتَ وَرَبُّكَ فَقَاتِلَ. When they said to Musa alayhi salam, اذْهَبْ أَنْتَ وَرَبُّكَ فَقَاتِلَ إِنَّا هُنَا قَاعِدُونَ. O Musa alayhi salam, you are a great mighty prophet. You and your Lord and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you go and fight, and we will wait here. The Sahabas were not like that. And they said to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I don't want to sidetrack, but it is extremely important. The Sahaba said to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we will not do as the other nations have done before. We will not say to you, go with your Lord and fight. We are sitting here. We are with you, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. وَتُعِينُونِي He said, yes, will you help me? Yes, I will help you. In other words, one of the most important essence of our deen, our religion, Islam, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to work as a group and not as individuals. For this is one of the reasons why it is compulsory for us to come to Jum'ah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can hear the dua and the prayer of each and every one of us. But no, we must come together. Why we come together? Because He wants us to work together. Praying together 27 times more than praying at home on my own. Allah can hear our prayer, can hear my dua. But together is 27. Why? Because we are required to work the way the Sahabas worked with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a group. They move together as a group. وَتُعِينُونِي قال فإن الله أمرني أن أبني هنا بيتا. I return to the story that is relevant today. Allah has commanded me to build a house here. وأشار إلى أكمة مرتفعة على ما حولها. And he pointed Ibrahim alayhi salam to a hill that is slightly raised compared to the rest of the areas around it. قال فعند ذلك رفع القواعد من البيت. At that point they both helped each other. They both raised the bases. In other words, the bases were there. If you use today's terminology, you say you pour concrete in the bases. So you put the bases first and then you build above the bases. So the Arabic language gives us the indication that the bases were there before Ibrahim. We do not have a proof. But this is one of the reading and one of the understanding of some of the scholars, that the bases were there and they are only lifting above the bases. Okay? فَجَعَلَ إِسْمَاعِيلِ يَأْتِي بِالْحِجَارَةِ وَإِبْرَهِيمِ يَبْنِي. The teamwork is here is two. It's not 200. One brings the stones, Ismail alayhi salam brings the stones, and Ibrahim alayhi salam puts the stones in courses to build the wall. وَإِبْرَهِيمِ حَتَّى إِذَا ارْتَفَعَ الْبِنَاءِ. When the building became high, meaning to the same height as Ibrahim alayhi salam, جَاءَ بِهَذَا الْحَجَرِ. Ibrahim alayhi salam does at the point where the wall becomes the same height as their height, he does not say, Alhamdulillah, خلاص, I've done what I can. لَا يُكَلِّفُ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِلَّا وَسْعَهَا. Allah does not burden us all more than he can cope. سَلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ. No, he is looking for ways to do more. He's not doing the minimum. He's not satisfied. رضي الله عنه وارضى عليه السلام. He's not satisfied عليه السلام with doing the complying. Let me just comply and get out. No, I'll comply. I will do my utmost and let me see if I can even go a little bit further. So they do something that we today know as a scaffold. So they bring us another stone so that Ibrahim عليه السلام can stand on that stone. In this case now he is taller. He can reach and he can build higher. وَهُمَا يَقُولَانَ. When they are both of them in the middle of nowhere, nobody's paying them, nobody can see them, and they are saying, رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا. Oh Allah, accept our actions. Accept our actions. They don't take it for granted. Who is this? This is Ibrahim alayhi salam. خَلِيلُ الرَّحْمَنِ. The friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, I am not sure if my action will be accepted or not. Please, Ya Allah, accept my action. Him and Ismail alayhi salam. We must never, tons of lessons contained in these ahadith and these statements that are mentioned in the Quran, that none of us should take ourselves for granted. Oh yeah, of course, I've done that for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now even Ibrahim alayhi salam, رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, in another ayah, in about the mu'mineen, وَالَّذِينَ سُرَةَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْتُونَ مَا آتَوْا. And those believers who do the actions of the believers, وَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِلَةٌ أَنَّهُمْ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ رَاجِعُونَ. And their hearts tremble, that knowing that they will return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning when I return to Allah, will this money, will this action that I've done, will this striving for, will this gathering of knowledge that I have done, will the walking that I have done, will it be accepted really for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or did I do it for another reason? Inshallah, if you are interested, we can do, redo, inshallah, a khutbah about hypocrisy and nifaq, because it's very important that, inshallah, although we did before, but it is important that we understand about this subject. You'll find the Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, عن أبي ذر الغفاري رضي الله عنه رضي الله عنه asked محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم about the following question. قلت يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أي مسجد وضع في الأرض أول؟ What is the first mosque that has been built on earth? What is the first mosque that has been built on earth? قال المسجد الحرام, the holy mosque in Kaaba. And we have an ayah in the Quran, inna awwala baytin wudi'a lin-nasi lalladhi bi-Bakkah mubarakan wa hudan lil-alamin. The first house that has been built for people is the one that exists in Bakkah, was the old name of Mecca. Now the house that exists in Mecca, mubarakan, it is a blessed place, wa hudan lil-alamin, as a means of guidance. طيب, so we are clear that the text, the Arabic in the text, gives us the indication, gives us the clear hint, and I say hint because there is not a hadith and there is not an ayah in the Quran that tells us who built the bases. We know for sure who raised the bases, who built above the bases is Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail because of an ayah in the Quran. But who actually built the bases? You'll find, and I sometimes, not to cause confusion, if there is a more than one opinion, sometimes I say these different opinions, not to cause confusion, but rather so that we are tolerant if you hear different opinion. You find that the ulama, based on the hadith and the Quran and the wording, they're analyzing the wording now. Since there is no hadith and there is no ayah that tells us for clear who built the bases, the ulama vary. Some of them say that the angels built the bases first. Okay? Some say Adam alayhi salam built the bases. And that is the opinion of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, ibn al-Jawzi, and ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, rahmatullah alayh, the one who explained the Sahih al-Bukhari. طيب. Another group, Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Qayyim al-Juzayyah, Ibn Kathir, these are very heavy weight ulama. They opined that no, it is Ibrahim alayhi salam who built it. Okay? But you will find there's many analysis and many, there are all explanations about what each word they would mean. And the probability, we say probability because we don't have a proof. The higher probability is that Adam alayhi salam is the one who built the bases and Ibrahim alayhi salam lifted the walls of Allah. Inshallah, you'll find that the Zamzam is very closely linked to Kaaba. You cannot talk about the Kaaba and the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail without talking about Zamzam. You find the Sahih Bukhari and Sa'id ibn Jubair and Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, أول ما تأخذ النساء المنطق من قبل أم إسماعيل. The first lady who has taken a belt from ladies was the mother of Ismail alayhi salam. When Ibrahim alayhi salam has taken her and her son Ismail to away from his first wife Hajar, and he took them to that desert place, she wanted to remove the traces of where she is walking, so she used that belt to remove the traces of where she is walking. And Ibrahim alayhi salam, inshallah, all of us know the story, so I will be brief in this one. And he placed them near Zamzam water, that there was no Zamzam, it's just near the place where it became later known as Zamzam. And he gave Umm Ismail a sack of dates. Her Ismail was a toddler at the time. He gave her a sack of dates and another sack that had water in it. And he turned his face, and that he put them in a valley where there is not a single human being. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Nothing. They did not have a pond, they did not have any running water. The only thing that they had was a sack of water and a sack of dates. And he turned his face and began to move away. Umm Ismail radiallahu anha, looking at this, it is quite natural. And she says to him, Ya Ibrahim, أين تذهب وتتركنا? Where are you going, Ibrahim alayhi salam? And you are leaving us in this place. بهذا الوادي الذي ليس فيه إنس ولا شيء. You put us here in a valley that doesn't have a single human being and not a single plantation. I want you even though that we know the story, if we can visualize that in the middle of a desert, very hot. We all know how hot it is, those of us, alhamdulillah, who have been there. Not a single human being, not a single plantation, no water. And you take your husband, your wife, and your toddler son, the only son that you've had after a very long period of time with having no sons at all, and you place them in that place, and you turn your back and you begin to move away. Alhamdulillah that Allah does not test us with any of this. Because I for myself, I would be the biggest failure. I would fail. I would be debating, why? What is the wisdom? Where? And I suspect many of us will be doing the same. فَقَالَتْ لَهُ ذَلِكَ مِرَارًا. Umm Ismail repeated the same question, where are you leaving us? وَجَعَلَ لَا يَلْتَفِتُ لَهَا. He's refusing to turn his face and look at her again, because out of love for them, he knows that probably my wedding, probably his eyes will be filled with tears. فَقَالَتْ, at that point, when she repeated it so many times, she realized something. Allahu amaraka bihada. In Arabic is the same as saying Allahu amaraka bihada. Okay, and if you studied with us Tajweed, you would know that if you have this, there is something called the tasheel. You say Allahu, an easement. Allahu, instead of saying Allahu, more difficult to pronounce. Did Allah commanded you to do this? Qala na'am. And you'll find another narration, he just nodded his head. قالت, her response, إِذَا لَا يُضَيِّعْنَا. Although we are in the middle of nowhere, there is no plantation, no water, not a single human being. But if it is Allah, if you are fulfilling the commands of Allah, then it's not an issue. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never waste us. And Ibrahim alayhi salam moved forward and he came to a slight elevated place and turned back and looked towards the Kaaba, which again gives us indication that the Kaaba bases were there already. استقبل بوجهه البيت ثم دعا بهؤلاء الكلمات. And then he made the famous dua in Surah Ibrahim. ربنا إني أسكنت من ذريتي بواد غير ذي زرع عند بيتك المحرم. Oh my Lord, I have put my family, my wife and my son in a place, in a valley that does not have any cultivation, near your Bayt al-Muharram, near the Kaaba. رَبَّنَا لِيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ. Oh Allah, so that they establish salah. Here is the dua now. I have fulfilled the command, ya Allah, that you commanded me to do. Although it's hard to put my son and my wife in the middle of the desert. So I have a dua, ya Allah, please. Don't leave them like that. فَاجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِمْ. Please put the love of that place in the hearts of people so that they flock coming visiting this place. فَاجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِمْ وَارْزُقْهُمْ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ. And give them some ثَمَرَات, give them rizq. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ, so that they may thank you, ya Allah. And the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam has been answered. The first thing that comes to your heart when you are leaving, if inshallah after you've done Umrah, if you have not done Umrah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you Umrah. If you have not done Hajj, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you the ability to do Hajj. The first thing that comes to your heart as the bus is leaving, when can I come back? And this is the answer of the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam, that your heart, so much love in our heart, is attached towards the Kaaba. And then Umm Ismail, after the baby has eaten, had drank all the water that she has, and then began to scream about, because he's hungry, he's thirsty. What can she do? If you can imagine a valley like that, and then a small hill here and a small hill there. One is called the Safa and one is called the Marwa. She ran and went up the Safa, so she can look at that valley to see, is there anybody? She ran and went up the Safa to look. She couldn't find anything. She came down and walked fast and came up to Marwa and to look again. She's in a higher place. She can look to see anybody. Is there anyone can help her? Couldn't find anything. And she did this 7 times, going backwards and forwards. And then she saw Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel alayhi salam, and Jibreel alayhi salam hit You will find in one narration with his foot, in another narration with a tip of his wing, they left the earth, and water began to gush out. And Umm Ismail, radiallahu anha wa Allah, she thinks it's natural, of course, this water is coming and it's all desert. So the desert will, the sand will absorb the water. So straight away she's trying to surround it. She's just trying to make like a boundary for the water, surround it, build like a dam around the water. So the end began to fill Harsa with this water. Ibn Abbas said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَرْحَمُ اللَّهُ أُمَّ إِسْمَعِيلٍ. May Allah forgive Umm Ismail. لَوْ تَرَكَتْ زَمْزَمْ. If she didn't try to contain Zamzam in this area, لَوْ تَرَكَتْ زَمْزَمْ أَوْ قَالْ لَوْ لَمْ تَغْرِفْ مِنَ الْمَاءِ. If she did not take water like this and just allowed it, لَكَانَتْ زَمْزَمْ عَيْنًا مَعِينًا. Zamzam would have become a huge lake. But Zamzam is now still exists, it's still providing us with fantastic water, but it is as a well.